And we can talk because we're gonna do voiceovers on this.
Your hands are perfectly fine. Mm-hmm. Just keep them, whatever you do, just keep it in that general spot, and you're fine. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. That's perfect. Very
Honey, if you go in the nail station in the back and you sit down, I think on the in the bottom drawer on the left, it could be the right side, I'm not sure, has some little hand brushes. Can you grab one for me? I need a nail. Oh, never mind. I have that thing. Are you still seeing my hand?
Yes, that's all. Checking. Make sure you're getting nothing that changed.
all of this fidgeting I'm doing, you cut that out. You can turn the TV on, you know, Craig. This is not going to be. We're going to do a voiceover on this.
Savings or visit an Xfinity store to learn how our Switch Squad makes switching fast and easy this holiday season.
Just call my money.
And as we head into 2022, pediatric hospitalizations from COVID are the highest they have ever been since the pandemic began. According to the CDC, an average of 378 children were admitted each day in the past week. Those hospitalizations are especially high in Houston. That's where CNN's Miguel Marquez has been speaking with officials about the effects of the Omicron variant in kids. Miguel?
Ryan, we visited Texas Children's Hospital. It's the one.
And get to the ballroom. He then cleaned up the blood. Later that afternoon, as the children arrived home, he murdered each one. The oldest boy, John, put up a struggle. He misfired him 10 times. He dragged the children's bodies to the ballroom, lined them up on sleeping bags next to their mother, and cleaned up more blood. With the executions over, Lisp said a prayer, then wrote the letter to his pastor, confessing the murders. He lowered the thermostat to slow the body's decomposition, turned on the radio to a classical music station, and began his life as a fugitive. Before the bodies were even discovered, Lisp made his way to Denver, applied for a new social security number as Robert Peter Clark. In time, he made friends with his neighbor Wanda Flannery, rejoined the Lutheran Church, and married Wanda's friend, Dolores Miller. His new wife never suspected a thing. Liz told her his first wife had died of cancer and that he had no children.
I do not believe it. I love her husband very deeply. I do not believe this is the same man.
The couple eventually moved back east to the Richmond, Virginia area, where Liz found an accounting job. Richard Walter's psychological profile accurately predicted almost every aspect of John List's flight from justice.
What was he doing when they caught him? He was a CPA. He was still a volunteer at the Lutheran Church. He kills his own mother, kills his own wife and his 3 kids. He's still volunteering at the Lutheran Church. He was still the same creature that he was when he killed him.
Nearly 20 years after the brutal murder of his entire family, a jury found John Lisp guilty of 5 counts of first-degree murder and sentenced him to life in prison.
John Ingram Lisp would be eternally synonymous with concepts of selfishness, horror, and evil. I'm just saying that the merger then became Morris's ancestors' work.
It was an invaluable tool in making a determination of how a guy would probably look. And it's just uncanny as to how close the sculpture was to the actual man.
I really paid attention to, I think, as much information as I had about Donald and what he was all, what he was about.
I truly believe it wasn't the fact that the anonymous was still there. Finally, we brought down this to justice.
As Peggy's car lay low in the hospital in the intensive care unit, doctors were back. They were interested in a lab test for all night. But one of the doctors noticed a tiny tooth. Her hair was falling out. It was a symptom of a very rare condition, one the doctor had never seen before. And if he was right, there was no known cure. Peggy Carr was a 21-year-old restaurant worker who had been married to her second husband, Pi, for the last 6 months. Peggy worked as a waitress in a drive-in restaurant and had 3 children from a previous marriage. Pi had 2 children and worked at a phosphate mine.
They seemed to be happy, my mom.
But soon after their marriage, Peggy began to question the long hours I was working at the mine.
We were out now. There were some questions about it being really at work while he was out.
One night when I said he was working late, Peggy drove out to the mine. In the parking lot, she saw only 2 cars. One was Pine. The other belonged to one of his former girlfriends. When Peggy learned of the affair, she took her children to
some time to think about us. I can't live like we have been. I can't imagine living without you, but I can if you don't want me. I love you with all my heart. Thank you.
After a brief separation, the couple resolved their differences and Peggy and her children moved back home. On the day she returned, Pi left for a previously scheduled hunting trip. While he was away, Peggy became ill, complaining of an upset stomach and an intense burning sensation. When Pi returned home, he told the children he thought it was only a virus.
She kept complaining of her hands and her feet. She said she couldn't open her eyes. She was nauseated.
By the time Peggy was taken to the hospital, doctors noticed some weakness in both sides of her face. But when lab tests were negative and they couldn't diagnose her problem, Peggy was released.
The next day, I went up to check on her, and she was even worse. And I told her that we needed to take her to the hospital again because she's not getting any better. Well, he went to work.
The children drove her to the hospital once again. This time, one of the physicians who examined her noticed a tiny clue.
I noticed that somebody raising her up off the pillow, if you listen to her back, quite a bit of her hair was left on the pillow.
Dr. Robert Van Hook and his colleagues thought it might be a poison, a very rare one, which doesn't show up in normal lab tests. A special test confirmed his suspicion. It was thallium poisoning. Thallium is a highly toxic metal, widely used as a pesticide before it was banned in the United States in 1972. Once inside the body, thallium attacks nerve endings and muscles, causing them to atrophy and die. In severe cases, it can cause delirium, paralysis, coma, even death. Tests reveal that Peggy had 50 times the maximum human exposure in her system, and there is no known cure or antidote. Within days, Peggy steps on track, and Tom Duane were hospitalized as well. They too had thallium poisoning.
Can you check the camera for me? I just bumped her in light.
You're fine. As long as you keep, as long as you keep what you're doing, you're good. Your hands are fine. As you'll keep them there. Once
daily, because I won't let UC stop me from being me.
Zeposia can help people with UC achieve and maintain remission, and it's the first and only S1P receptor modulator approved for UC. During Zeposia, if you've had a heart attack, chest pain, stroke, or mini stroke, heart failure in the last 6 months, irregular or abnormal heartbeat, now corrected by a pacemaker, if you have untreated severe breathing problems during your sleep, or if you take medicines called MAOIs. Zeposia may cause serious side effects, including that can be less present and cause death, slow heart rate, and other breathing problems, caused by large molecular edema, and swelling and narrowing of the brain's blood vessels. Normal likely, a risk of CML, a rare serious potentially fatal brain infection, cannot be ruled out. Tell your doctor about all your medical conditions, medications, if you are or plan to come back here, if you can't tell right now.
So get the flexibility of the new mobile service designed for your small business. Introducing Comcast Business Mobile. You get the most reliable network and nationwide 5G included. And you get unlimited data for just 30.
I keep messing up that one nail. In fact, the third time I had to stick one on there.
The video is good.
No, thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Right, wait till you get one.
Can I have one of those files in here?
Where is it from?
In the air cracker.
Okay, let me see that. Okay.
The black ones?
That's all there's a white
one. Okay, inside this thing. This, in the second drawer down towards the back. This thing right here? You know that thing? Oh, never mind. This is what I'm looking for.
That the killer was very smart, very organized, and would be
when they're afraid of addiction, but not of hard work, they keep it going. When cupboards are empty, but wishlists are full, they keep it going. Your mother donations through the pandemic have helped rescue Christmas for families in need. But now more than ever, we need your help to keep it going. When you give $25 a month, you help families stay in their homes. Thanks to you, hope marches on.
Pick that up quick. Oh God. I don't want it to spill on the floor. Thank you.
This life-saving act holds the key to human being. It's time to choose your path. Humanity.
Slipped into a coma. Her doctors had little if any hope for her recovery. Her son and stepson were both in serious condition and expected to recover. Pye's daughter, Tanya, was the only family member without Valium in her system. She told police she didn't drink the soda because she consumed only diet drinks. And when Valium was found in Pye's system, he was no longer considered a suspect. No other leads. The FBI was able to provide a psychological profile of the poisoner. The profiling unit believed that the poisoner was highly intelligent, a white male in his mid-30s who resolved conflict without direct confrontation. He liked to read about murder, watch violent movies, and would then fantasize about committing murder.
It's more of a passive type of person. And it's a more cowardly type of crime. You don't have to look the intention in the eye.
The FBI suggested police question the neighbors because whoever poisoned the family knew their comings and goings and planted the soda without being seen. The Carr's only neighbor was Dr. Diana Carr, no relation to Peggy Carr, and her husband, George Treepel. Diana Carr had a master's degree in chemistry and graduated from medical school as an orthopedic surgeon. Her husband, George, was a freelance writer for a computer magazine. Both were highly intelligent and members of Mensa, an organization for individuals with IQs in the top 2% of the population. Police learned that Diana Carr had a fight with Peggy just a week before she was poisoned.
She was cussing Matt and Reagan about my two brothers having music on in the front yard, telling me to turn it down.
My mom had enough of this lady, you know, yelling at her, screaming at her, cussing at her, so she turned around and walked off, and I'm done talking.
This ain't over yet.
A background check revealed that Trinpaul had been arrested in North Carolina in the mid-70s for running one of the largest methamphetamine labs in the eastern United States. The drug agent who arrested Trinpaul called him the smartest chemist he had ever known. On March 3rd, 1989, 4 months after she was poisoned, Peggy Carr died. It was now a murder investigation. The sheriff's department assigned Special Agent Susan Gore to the case. She was asked to go undercover to infiltrate the Mensa group to which George Trepal and Diana Carr belonged, an experience she vividly described in her best-selling book, Poison Mind. Under an assumed name and identity, Susan Gore attended a Mensa murder mystery weekend, which George and his wife Diana were hosting.
Before I went to the weekend, I spoke with the people at the FBI Behavioral Science Unit to see if I could get some tips on the type of person or type of personality that I should develop if I was to meet George Trepal.
When Gore arrived for the weekend, he received a copy of the murder scenarios George Trepal wrote for the participants. One was a murder by poisoning.
Jane Voodoo is believed.